نحمده ونصلي على رسول الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم My dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum again for the second time. I hope you have had your refreshments and replenished your energies with caffeine or liquids. So we are all set, inshallah, to go into the second part of our learning experience. When a child is born, it's like the learning process starts. It starts from the cradle and continues to the end of life, from the cradle to the grave. And when a new Muslim accepts Islam, they are like a newborn child. Alhamdulillah, they are like a newborn child, mainly from the concept of being sinless, but also from the concept of learning in life. Their learning process in their new environment, new life, new faith, starts from the day they accept their faith, and maybe they know something before that also. But the next topic will explore this in a little more detail, how a new Muslim, a person who accepts Islam, gets into the process of learning the faith and his practice. And to enlighten us on that is Imam Khalid Qasmi, the Imam of Al-Farooq Masjid, inshallah. Brother Khalid Qasmi. I am intentionally abbreviating all the introductions. He's a well-known person. So we'll just go ahead and continue, inshallah. Quickly try to gain up for the make up for the lost time, inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الدين عند الله الإسلام وقال عز وجل ومن يبتغي غير الإسلام دينا فلن يقبل منه وهو في الآخرة من الخاسرين بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم All praises are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him. We seek His help. We seek His refuge from the evil in our souls and from the evil in our actions. And for whom He allows to be on the hidayah, whomsoever He guides, there is none to misguide Him. And for whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows to go astray, there is none to lead him to the right path, to guide him. I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship except Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and messenger. My dear brothers and sisters, we have learned so much in the first section about the experiences of some of our new Muslim brothers and sisters who came under the fold of Islam through someone or through their own research, through their own experiences. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with hidayah. So the journey into Islam was described by some, but with me, you will have a journey into Islam. What about the concept of Islam, about the teachings of Islam, what Islam actually is? And why we call it Islam? Is it the new religion? Or it has been the path of all the generations which came before us in this world, of all the messengers and prophets who were sent down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the mankind. So we'll find out the answers, inshallah, in this speech. Especially in these times when so many barriers placed in the path of Islam and so many misconceptions, so many untruths are spread about the teachings of Islam. This is a great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give some specific individuals the path of hidayah. And He blesses them to understand the truth, to understand the light of Islam. So a new Muslim, and for that matter, I would say every Muslim, should always be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has blessed them. He has blessed them with ever-important knowledge of Islam and understanding of the same, and bringing them to part towards the path of Hidayah, and that is Islam. Islam is the ultimate success, is the ultimate motto or goal for a human being in this world. What is Islam? Islam comes as a verbal noun from Aslama Yuslimu Islaman. The meaning of it is he resigned or he submitted himself. And with regard or with respect to God, it means he submitted to the will of God. When a person comes under the fold of Islam, so he submits his will, his life, every action of his to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and become a Muslim. And as he grows into this field, into this arena, into this realm, he finds himself doing things which are pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he becomes pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as he goes deeper and deeper, the result is that he grows more love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, more love to Islam, and more love to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in the process become a perfect Muslim. So, is this the word Islam and the submission to God is the actual meaning of Islam? Is it the concept which was given by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or this is the concept which was given by every single prophet throughout the history of human race? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Quran, شَرَعَ لَكُم مِّنَ الدِّينِ مَا وَصَّى بِهِ نُوحًا وَالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ وَمَا وَصَّيْنَا بِهِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى وَعِيسَى أَنْ أَقِيمُوا الدِّينَ وَلَا تَتَفَرَّقُوا فِيهِ. We come to conclusion that the religion of all the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was Islam, and they were all Muslims. Meaning Nuh, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, all were Muslims. And their religion was Islam, true and sincere submission to God. And that was the preached to their people. And the ayah in Quran says that the same religion has he has established for you as that which he enjoined on Nuh, that which we have sent to you, and that which we enjoined upon Abraham, Moses, and Jesus. It means that all the prophets throughout the human race were Muslims. They were sincere in their submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is established fact mentioned in Quran by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at another place, beautifully Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, and he addressing the people of other faith, saying, أَمْ تَقُولُونَ إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وإسماعيل وإسحاق ويعقوب والأسباط كانوا هودا ونصارى قل أنتم أعلم أم الله ومن أظلم ممن كتم شهادة عنده من الله وما الله بغافل عما تعملون. Allah says in that, do you know better, or does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows better? What do you say, Abraham, Ishmael, Isaac, Jacob, and the 12 sons of Jacob were Jews or Christians? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking this question from these people. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say, قُلْ أَنْتُمَ عَلَمُوا أَمِ اللَّهِ. Do you know better, or does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala know better that they were all Muslims? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعَمَلُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not unaware of what you do. تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ. They were people who passed on. They were gone. And تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ. They will be asked, they shall receive the reward of what they did. وَلَكُمْ مَا كَسَبْتُمْ. And you of what you are doing. وَلَا تُسْأَلُونَ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. And you will not be asked about the actions, about the things which they did in their lives. my dear brothers and sisters, again, this is saying, and this is also established fact that with the human race, the submission of God was established and it was taught to them by every single Nabi, every single Rasul, meaning Prophet and Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ultimate lesson and the ultimate way towards God was given by himself, that this is the only recommendation, this is the only way to follow the path towards pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, inna deena indallahi al-Islam, the only religion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Islam. Islam, again I'm telling, is true submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whosoever follows other religion other than Islam, then it will not be accepted from him. وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْ. And whosoever adopts a religion other than Islam, it will never be accepted from him, and he will be among the losers on the Day of Judgment. That's what has been mentioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, we know that Islam or the teachings of Islam, they have been there for entire mankind, taught by all the prophets. So what is the difference between all the Anbiya, all the prophets, and the last and final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We have to understand this is over here. What is the difference then? So there are very important 2 points that demonstrate the relationship between the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the way of all the true Anbiya came before him. 1 point, the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam abrogates the previous way. The second point, that by wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah did not allow the teachings of the previous prophets of Islam or of their deen to remain preserved in a completely undistorted manner. There were some tampering, there were some changes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not promise to protect them and to keep them intact. Unlike the Quran, the last and final message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to mankind. So two things are to be remembered, that the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam abrogates the way of the all Anbiya who came before him, and the scriptures, the kutub or the books which were sent down by Allah, they were tampered with. There were changes in there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the same thing in Quran. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ بِالْحَقِّ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ وَمُهَيْمِنًا عَلَيْهِ فَاحْكُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ عَمَّا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. Allah says, we have sent down to you, O Muhammad, the book in truth, confirming the scripture that came before it, and a witness over it, all these old scriptures. So judge between them by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed, and follow not their vain desires, diverging away from the truth that has come to you. In this ayah, we learn that there was demonstrating that the Quran has been revealed in the truth and confirms what has been revealed before it, or beforehand of the all revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's a judge and witness over all the previous books. And in other words, we can say that it preserves, protects, and witnesses to the truth and that was found in the earlier books sent down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a musaddiq. It's verifying all the good teachings of the previous books, which were sent down by Allah to mankind. Now, the Quran is there for all of us as a book of hidayah, guidance for all to follow. So the goal of Islam is for all entire mankind to become true servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, the source of guidance and foundation has to be perfect and has to be in accordance with all the actions that are revealed in the revelations from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's from the point, this point we come to conclusion that the scholars speak about the sources of law of Islam, sources of teachings of Islam, and they are two. The two ultimate authorities in Islamic law are Quran and the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Quran is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a revelation that came directly to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam via Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, an angel who was given the errand to run. He was given an assignment that he would bring the wahi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to all the prophets, including Sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And when Allah's Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to receive this revelation or wahi from Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, he used to pass the words to all his followers and would those who used to write and ask them to write it down and put it in the record. And that's why the compilation of Quran has come into existence. My dear brothers and sisters, Quran is a mu'jiza, is a miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which he himself took the guarantee, took the responsibility to preserve it, to protect it. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Indeed, we have revealed Quran, and indeed we are protecting it. We will preserve it. We will be the authority to preserve it, to protect it. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Quran. And the second thing, which is also a part of revelation of wahi, is called wahi ghair matlu. The wahi matlu, the wahi which is recited, is Quran, that we recite every day in our life. And the other way of wahi is the wahi ghair matlu, a kind of revelation which is not recited. And that is the sayings, the actions, and the examples from the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is called the sunnah or the ahadith. This is the second important pillar of knowledge in Islamic Sharia, next to Quran. And I'm not saying that we are following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, considering him a kind of a semi-god or something like that. No, the authority to follow the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He authorized us. He authorized Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be followed by us. That we have to follow each and every way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his commands. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Quran, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. And whosoever obeys the messenger, indeed he obeyed Allah. وَمَنْ تَوَلَّى فَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ عَلَيْهِمْ حَفِيظًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the one who turns away from the teachings, then we have not sent you as a watcher over them. It's not your responsibility to go after him, to push him, to force him to follow your way. Your job is done. وَمَا عَلَيْكَ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ. And there is nothing on you except that you reach the message and your job is done. So the authority of us following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at many places in Quran. My dear brothers and sisters, the teachings of Islam are not merely rituals, name some dogmas, some practices, some mystery. It's a clear way towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a clear way, it's a most comprehensive way to lead our life in accordance with the commandments of our Creator, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we divide that way into two sections. One is related to belief, faith, and the other is related to practice. The articles of faith and the pillars of practice in Islam. And the first and foremost article of faith, when I'm coming under the fold of Islam, I have to testify the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is one and only. He is absolute in his power. There is none like unto him. He has no partners. He has no wives. He has no children. And there is none like unto him. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. This is the belief in Allah's oneness. And also, This ultimate monotheism, Tawheed, bring us all the questions which were raised down by Brother Bob Palmer, he was mentioning, or Brother Sabri Mateen, Brother Mateen. They were saying that he was confused. Who am I? What am I doing here in this world? Where am I heading to? What's the purpose of my being created in this way, in this form? Almost, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the reasons. And some point of time in our life, it hits it. It comes to a point where we have to think about it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's tawheed says all these questions, all answers all these questions. Who am I? Who created me? لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Indeed, we have created man in the best of form. Our creator is one and only, and he is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where am I heading to? What will happen to me? يَوْمَ يَصْدُرُ النَّاسُ أَشْتَاتًا لِيُرَوْا أَعْمَالَهُمْ فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَى. They will be gathered together on the day of resurrection in different groups, and they will see their amal, their deeds which they committed in this worldly life. If somebody did good, he'll be rewarded accordingly. And somebody did not good, or he went in against the Sharia of Islam, or he did not follow the commandments of his creator, that he may be punished. He will see it. Everyone will see the actions committed in this worldly life. And that's what Brother Mateen Sahib beautifully said, that we know the birth date, we know the end date, when we are going to die. Everybody knows that he will die one day, and that will be the fixed date. But the dashing in between is the life, and we have to worry about it. It has to be in accordance with the commandments of our God. And that's the space, that the dashing will be answerable on the day of resurrection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how we led it. And the first thing is that we have to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a reminder for all of us. Tawheed is the most important pillar of Islam. If we don't do that, we are not Muslims. We are not followers of Quran, Sunnah, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We are not followers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second thing which we have to do is to believe in his angels. And these articles of faith have been mentioned in a hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Amantu billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi wal yawmil akhir wal qadri khayrihi wa sharrihi min Allah ta'ala wal ba'thi ba'd al maut." Tawheed, believing in angels. Angel is a type of creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are not like human beings. They have been created of light. They are not to be seen by men, and they have been created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do not commit any sins. They are a special creation of Allah, and they do not commit any sins. They do not commit any kind of thing which is against the irada, against the intention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe in their existence. This is a part of our faith. We believe in all the books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down from him on the prophets in their times, like Torah, Injil, Dawood, and then Zabur, which was sent to Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam, and finally the book which was sent down to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, that is Quran, the last and final book by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe in all the messengers being Muslims. All the messengers, they are humans. They were like us, but they have been given a special mission, a special job to do, and that was to carry the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to their people. Different times, different rates, different people. They've been sent down for the guidance of mankind with the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wahi used to come to them. They are the prophets and messengers, and they are humans like us. And finally came the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also about the sending of prophets, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Quran, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. That indeed we have sent in each qawm among the people a messenger saying that أُعْبُدُ اللَّهَ, worship Allah and stay away from different false deities, from different gods. do not associate them with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning the message of Tawheed, oneness. And then the belief in the last day, and that is the day hereafter. The last day is called such because there will be no new day after that. Those who will be granted paradise shall be in their abode, and those who will be thrown into the hellfire will be so. They will be residing there forever. And this day, the Akhirah, is also called the day of resurrection, the reality, the event, the judgment, day of judgment. The overwhelming, different names are there. We believe in the existence. We believe in the existence of paradise, being Muslims, and we believe in the existence of hellfire. If we do good, we'll be rewarded paradise. And if we did something wrong, which was not in accordance with the commandments of my Lord, we'll be thrown into the depth of hellfire. So the existence of both is part of our belief. And also, we believe in qada and qadr. We believe that whatever happens, happens with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. He knew both the universe and particulars before even the existence of the same. And we believe in the qada, and meaning that we believe in Allah's recordings of all things before He created the heavens and earth. And also, believing in qada means to believe in Allah's decreeing of everything and everything that is in the existence. And and if He does not will something, it can never come into existence. And the belief of qadar is also belief in Allah's creating of everything, bringing of everything into existence, and making everything as they are now. This is the belief in the qada and qadr. My dear brothers and sisters, this is a part which I'm talking about related to faith. The other part which is related to practice has been mentioned in Quran, and we know it that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, "Buni al-Islamu ala khams, shahadati an la ilaha illallah, wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, wa iqam as-salati wa ita'i az-zakah, wal hajj wa sawm Ramadan." Allah subhanahu Allah's messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us a beautiful parable, yani making it like a house which is standing on five pillars. So all these five tenets of Islam are pillars. If any of them is weak, there will be weakness in the foundation of that house. The first and foremost is, of course, believing in oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have discussed it. And the second thing is establishing prayer five times a day. Iqamus salah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not mention the salat, thus prayer. Iqama means establishing the prayer, the way it should be done in accordance with the commandments of Allah and the commandments of His last messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, offering the salah five times a day in their own times, prescribed times, in the state of purity, with true heart, and focusing our attention towards this ibadah with humbleness and humility and submissiveness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In all true sense of the word, this act of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to be established. Third pillar is paying zakat. Zakat, charity, regular charity, which has to be given by every single Muslim. By every single Muslim, male and female, who are mature and who possess such amount of money upon which zakat is further. And they have to, it has to be taken out at the end of the year. The whole year passes over that for property. 2.5% of that amount has to be given to those categories prescribed in Quran by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't have time to go into detail of it right now. And the fourth thing is, fourth pillar of Islam is fasting in the month of Ramadan. And if staying away from eating, drinking, indulging in physical relationship with one's spouse from dawn till dusk, the whole month of Ramadan, that is called fasting. And it has been prescribed as an obligation by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the last and final prayer of Islam is to go to visit to house the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Mecca once in a lifetime, if one has a means to do so, and one is both financially and physically sound. So these are basically the five tenets of Islam. My dear brothers and sisters, this is just a reminder for all of us. The one is related to faith and the other is related to practice. So this is Islam. And apart from it, there are other branches of Islam with akhlaqiyat, mu'amalat, mu'asharat, how we live in this world, how we treat with people, and how we deal in our businesses and everything. All are the particles of Islam. What is haram, what is halal. When we come under the fold of Islam, we learn all about these things. My dear brothers and sisters, but petty things happen. For example, as soon as somebody comes under the fold of Islam, he's worried about changing the names. Changing the name is not required unless it has some bad meaning or the meaning which is not in accordance with Islamic Sharia. Then you may change it. Otherwise, it's not required. Similarly, there's a confusion happens as soon as a Muslim and somebody, some new brother or sister comes under the fold of Islam, and they happen to be confused about following one particular school of thought. I mean, it should not be the focal point of our attention, because Islam is very clear, Quran is clear, and the ahadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is clear. There are some places, there are some issues related to practice which may be contradicting with each other. And in this case, there may be two approaches. One approach is that I will have to myself go into details of it, of every issue, find, open the books of ahadith, Bukhari, Muslim, Nasai, and etc. Go into the tafaseer of Quran, find out the meaning or the related issues together, find out the masala. And the second approach can be that I follow the people who are far better than me. They had more knowledge. They had more piety and taqwa in their lives. They were more pious. And they were closer to the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us actually with those people who put down all these issues, all these principles, all these things for us to follow. Just the thing is we have to follow. And the best opinion I would like to share with you is that inshallah, if some sister or brother comes under the fold of Islam, instead of getting confused about this, so look around the vicinity you are living in, go, the masjid you are going to, the community or the brothers or sisters, what is the majority and what is the school of thought which the majority of that locality follows. Inshallah, go with it. Follow your imam of the masjid who is there for you to lead you in all affairs related to your worldly life, to the life of the hereafter. My dear brothers and sisters, time is not allowing me. I'm already past about four minutes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to understand Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us on this path where He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has guided us. When so long as we live in this world, we live on this path, and inshallah, in the hereafter, we may gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the ultimate success and happiness. Ameen wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.